So, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to another edition of Celtic Talk Radio Live 14 Cents. Tonight it is the Sunday, and Celtics played in Chicago the game number 4 of the series in the first round of the playoffs. Sunday, 23rd. April 2017, around 10:40 p.m. Eastern Time, when we are recording. I'm telling this because I want you to know that this is post game set and recording, in fact. And I want to tell this tonight we are celebrating the great victory, the second consecutive in Chicago, of the Boston Celtics, because the Celtics dominated in Chicago, 104-95. The Bulls are showing signs of desperation, nervous. They are trying with some cheap hits to downplay the Celtics' win, to say that the Celtics are cheaters, the Celtics are floppers, the officials are waiting for the Celtics to be total bullcrap. So, 104-95 is the result of the game 4. The game 5 is Wednesday night in Boston. The game 6 is, if I'm correct, Friday night in Chicago, and potential game 7 will be the next Sunday. So basically it's like 0-0, and it is the best of three series, with the Boston Celtics having home court advantage. So, Celtics players must behave like it is 0-0, like it is the game 1. We didn't achieve anything, but I say that it is obvious that the Celtics players swing the momentum of the series. You know, the Bulls will say that it is thanks to Rajon Rondo's injury, but I would say it is thanks to Brad Stevens' great coaching, adjustment, inserting Green into starting lineup, putting terrible Amir Johnson out of rotations and out of starting lineup, which is something I'm preaching the whole season. And finally, Brad Stevens is proving me right. And thanks to Brad Stevens for getting his senses finally, and thanks Gerald Green for saving the Celtics. I must say, not alone, but practically. Danny, if you want to say something, we have some interesting statements from the Bulls. Fred Hoiberg, and from the Bulls star, Jimmy Butler. So if you want, Danny, you can say some words and play the audios, and we have some hot takes, because the Bull Presser just gave us fantastic material for opening of the show. We thought not to mention, officiating, because unlike the fans and organization and coach, we are classy guys. Despite officiating was terrible, one-sided, like the whole series, Bulls-sided, and it is obvious that NBA doesn't want the Celtics to be in the Eastern Conference Finals, because some of the prognoses are even giving 10% chance more to the Celtics to reach the big finals than the Cavaliers. So, I'm not into conspiracy theories, but this is the reason why NBA office and officials are so one-sided, because the Celtics are the only team that is having home court advantage over Cavaliers at the Eastern Conference. Celtics are realistically the only team when it's healthy and full strength that can win against the Cavaliers in playoff series. This is a long stretch. Cavaliers will be favorites, but again, the Celtics have, in my opinion, the biggest chance to knock down Cavaliers. I'm not saying that this is realistic. Cavaliers are still the big favorites, but just comparing to the other Eastern Conference teams, I think that the Celtics are having the most chance to knock down Cavaliers. And LeBron James and Kevin Love and Perry Hill. By the way, Cavaliers swept Indiana Pacers. Officiating was terrible, as always, when Cavaliers are playing one-sided. And but Indiana Pacers are guilty alone, and we will see in which direction Indiana will go. I would not care less at the moment because I'm concentrating on the Boston Celtics, but just saying that number two seed at the Eastern Conference advanced in the second round of the playoffs by sweeping Indiana Pacers 4-0. Danny, opening words and out.
Well, it was a big win overall, as you said, Igor. As you said, many people are going to be basically trying to sweep this under the rug by saying that this is not a big thing because Rajon Rondo isn't playing. But last I checked, the Celtics are also having to play through some adversity due to the situation with Isaiah Thomas' sister. As we mentioned on our last video chat, the last we heard is that the funeral hasn't even taken place, so I wouldn't be surprised knowing that now they got tomorrow and Tuesday off before Game 5 if Isaiah ends up leaving the team again to go be with his family, which is probably what's going to end up happening. So Brad Stevens already announced that tomorrow will be a day off for the team, so the guys will be resting here in Boston while Isaiah Thomas probably travels out, so he'll probably miss the practice Tuesday and then return in time to basically play Game 5. So the Celtics are dealing with just as much adversity as the Chicago Bulls. On top of it, you know, as you said, we're dealing with a, you know, officiating crew thus far that is pretty much favoring the Chicago Bulls team because they got Dwayne Wade and Jimmy Butler. Dwayne Wade and Butler are getting more respect than Isaiah Thomas and Al Horford have thus far, and yet Al Horford and Isaiah Thomas's team is the number one seed, while Butler and Wade are the number eight seed, a number eight seed that barely got into the playoffs. So, you know, today, again, when we read the stats, ladies and gentlemen, if you're someone that didn't watch the game, you'll know what I'm talking about. But today was more about this team making some big-time shots. Gerald Green went off like crazy in the first half, and he really helped the Celtics build a big enough lead that once the Bulls managed to finally get hot and they went on their own run, they were able to take the lead, but they wasted all their energy for the most part getting back to it. So Jimmy Butler, think about it. Butler had to play 46 minutes, Igor, out of the 48 minutes played in this game in order to actually keep the Bulls in contention. If Jimmy Butler doesn't play 46 out of 48, this game is a blowout, ladies and gentlemen. So that's something the Chicago Bulls fans got to realize, and the coach has to realize for Chicago as well. It's not whatever it is you're complaining about when it comes to Isaiah Thomas carrying the ball or Marcus Smart doing an acting job or anything like that. It's that the rest of your team outside of Butler and Wade can't do anything, basically, for the most part, if the Celtics are basically zoning in on them. You know, Lopez, the Celtics have now basically found a way to really negate him. The last two games, he hasn't really been much of a threat ever since Gerald Green basically got it put into the series, because now Amir Johnson is not clogging the paint and allowing Lopez to stay down there. Now Lopez has to come out of the paint, and it's made things totally different. Today, he barely got any minutes, if I'm wrong correct. He barely got to play compared to the way he's played in games 1 and 2. So, ladies and gentlemen, in Chicago, this is not about Isaiah Thomas. This is about the fact that nobody else outside of Butler, really, and Wade is doing anything for your team now, especially your bench. The Celtics bench are playing your bench in games 3 and 4, and now you're tied with us coming back to Boston for it. So look at that rather than actually complaining about what the Celtics players might be doing.
I will be comments about these statements from the Bulls and officiating. I really didn't want to comment about officiating, but the Bulls' statements forced me forced me and us to speak about it. We want to speak about the game itself, and we will speak about the game itself. So, Danny, let you play those audios, and we will back to the first studio after the audio, okay?
How would you characterize the contributions of Gerald Green early in these games and what he's done regarding your switch to starting him in the lineup?
Well, I think the biggest thing, Dan, is that he everybody in the league and been around the league knows that he can go on these runs, right? And so he's a guy that you have to account for. And so it just opens up space for other people, and if he's going to get open looks, you feel really good about him getting a chance to knock him down. He's provided obviously some shooting, but he's also, gotten a couple of drives to the basket at key times. He had that one at the start of the second half that was big when things weren't going our way. And, he's a guy that stayed ready all year, and his attitude has been great all year. Like, it's regardless play or not, he's always ready.
Is there any physical limitation to him in the second half? Because he's got a couple wraps on there late in the game.
No. No, not that I know of. I just think he had a lot of wraps and tried to put him back in there one time, and there were so many wraps on there he couldn't get them off.
Coach Mark D'Amico, Celtics.com, and rewind.
That's why we have to start him.
Started a second ago about the finals. Talk a little bit about just really finding a way to overcome that, because it wasn't just you. It was really all the wings that were trying to do with Jimmy.
Yeah. I think he's shot 23 free throws, more than us.
Third most in franchise history for opponent in the playoffs.
Yeah, let's just leave it there. I don't want to get fired.
Going back home, which hasn't been good for either team in this series, what's the key for you guys to change that around at this point?
I think our mentality has to be take care of home and continue to play the right way. We should take pride playing in front of our fans and playing the right way.
What does it say that you guys were able to come in here and even the series?
It says a lot about us. It reminds me of what kind of team we were at the beginning of the year, and that's a team that continues to fight, always playing, always playing with a mentality like we're the underdogs. And playing that way, it's almost like we're playing with our backs against the wall, and we have to continue to play that way. I know Brad's going to continue to remind us that we can't get comfortable and then think this series is over, because they're going to bring it next game.
As far as the Marcus Smart situation goes, he's a great actor, acting tough. That's what he does. But I don't think he's about that. I just don't think I'm the wrong guy to get in my face. Not so. He need to take it somewhere else, because I'm not the one for that.
Is that the first time you said something
to you,
or has that been going on this
week? I think, yeah, that's the first time. Last time, too. We're not going to sit here and get in each other's faces like that. Like I said, he's not about that life, so he's calming down.
I guess you guys come into Chicago, take both games, even this series. What does this trip say about this team?
This shows our heart. They came in our place, and then they took two at our place. We knew it was going to be hard coming in here on their home court and winning. And, I'm sure a lot of people didn't think we were going to be able to do it. We came and did it. We stuck with each other. It just shows the heart and determination of this team.
Yeah, the Bulls came all the way back from 20 points down to take a lead in the third quarter. How did you guys stay together to get that momentum back?
The boys, all those veteran guys on the team, talking to one another, making sure everybody's together, and just making sure we do what we're supposed to do and listen to coach and the schemes that they drew up. And we executed that, and we came out with the victory.
Closed the quarter on a 16-5 run. Isaiah Thomas had a hand in every single one of those points. Is he back?
He's back. It feels good to have him back. He lost his groove for a little bit. He got it back. And it's good to see him back. He helps his team out a lot, and we needed that tonight.
Marcus, looking forward to game four. They seem to have found something with Isaiah Cannon. What adjustments can you guys make there?
He's set, pretty much the whole season. So, he came in with a chip on the shoulder. We just got to, get him back on the scouting report. And we know what Isaiah likes to do. He's a great player. So, we got to respect him a little bit more, especially from outside. And when we switch up to him, we got to get inside and take it to the hole.
Marcus, thank you. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Okay.
Okay, so we are done with videos, I mean audios, and we heard everything that has been said on the presser. It was funny, but when I was looking at the Bulls, I felt like I'm watching Benny Hill or Flying Circus of Monty Python. I mean, this is not even funny, this is sad what they are saying. And this is not true. Simply saying this is bullcrap. And what is the saddest part is that I'm reading on the Twitter that some Celtics fans are actually giving support to those Fred Hoiberg's comments that of officials actually helped the Celtics in a way by letting Isaiah Thomas to carry the ball too much, etc. Let me say to those fans that they should be embarrassed of themselves and they should just disappear and never write anything about the Celtics, and they should not even call themselves the Celtics fans. Fred Hoiberg showed with these statements, Daniel, that he is desperate, he is afraid of losing his job, because he blew up the 2-0 lead, and the most likely he will lose this series. I will find the picture, Danny, that I posted at the page, and after this game was actually pivotal game. Before this game, the Bulls were the favorites to win this series after the 3. And after this very game, the BPI, which is again mathematical algorithm for determining the percent and the chances for the teams to win some playoff series. So the Celtics were 24 chances to win this series after the game 2. And now after the game 4, the Celtics are 69% to win the series. And Bulls are 31%. So the Bulls are having 56% home game win. I suppose this is game 6. Yeah. Anyway, they have 29% to win away game win. So they are overall BPI ranking number 15. The Celtics have 69% to win the series, 71% to win the home game. That's number 5. Then the Celtics having 44% to win game number 6 in Chicago. And the most likely, the Celtics are going to finish winning the series in 7, according to BPI, 37% to win in 7, and 31% to win in 6 games, the Celtics. And the Bulls' chances are slim now. The chances Bulls to win in 6 are 16%, and in 7 games, it's 15%. So, it's a big swing between 24% chance to win the series after game 2 and 69% to win the series after the game 4, Daniel. And this is the reason why Mr. Hoiberg is nervous. And I have something interesting. According to 538, the Celtics have better chance of reaching NBA Finals than Cavaliers. Celtics are having 69% chances to, 69% chances to win this series against the Bulls, 42% chance to win the conference finals, and Wizards having 38% to win the conference finals. The chances to reach to the big finals for the Celtics are, Daniel and dear ladies and gentlemen, 25%. For example, Wizards are having 21% to reach the big finals, and Cavaliers are having 22% to reach the big finals. And it is almost certain that, the Celtics are favorites in potential round 2 matchup between Celtics and Wizards, 42% and 38%. Again, this is according to 538. Missing some team by team forecast. It is interesting. Do you want to comment about those prognosis, Daniel, or not?
I'll comment on that, and of course we'll comment on what you said about the coach. Listen, Igor, we actually got the audio of what the Bulls coach said. So listen to the complaining, ladies and gentlemen, that this coach is making.
Isaiah Thomas is a hell of a player, an unbelievable competitor. He's a warrior, everything he's going through right now. He had a hell of a game tonight. But when you're allowed to discontinue your dribble on every possession, he is impossible to guard. He's impossible to guard. Isaiah Thomas is a hell of a player, an unbelievable competitor. He's a warrior, everything he's going through right now. He had a hell of a game tonight. But when you're allowed to discontinue your dribble on every possession, he is impossible to guard. He's impossible to guard. When you're able to put your hand underneath the ball and take two or three steps and put it back down, it's impossible to guard him in those situations.
So again, that Hoiberg is one great comedian, and this act is would be done great part from Flying Circus of Monty Python or Ben Hill. But sadly, this is the press conference of one coach in the playoffs. So he should be ashamed of himself. The Bulls should fire him if he loses this series, whatever he has been speaking. Let us a little comment about officiating. And again, the Celtics fans that are supporting those idiotic statements from the Bulls, Butler and Hoiberg, are total idiots and should be ashamed of themselves. And I don't care what they think about me, but they are total idiots for supporting the Bulls statements. The ones that are actually supporting those statements. About the officiating, let us see the statistics. For example, the free throws. The free throws, the Celtics are like 18 out of 22 free throws, okay? And the Bulls free throws, let me see, 26 out of 33. So 33 free throws for, the Bulls and 22 for the Celtics, plus 11. And this is not good officiating for Hoiberg. Let us see Jimmy Butler free throw situation. Jimmy Butler is having 19 out of 23 free throws. When somebody gave him the bad look, he received the free throw because he is superstar on the paper. On the court, he is not. Isaiah Thomas is clearly better player, and he is dominating the series. And I want to say hello to all the idiots and writers that are saying that Jimmy Butler is the best player in the series. He is not, and Isaiah Thomas proved them so bad tonight, because they were saying, like, all the Bulls have to do is to put Jimmy Butler on Isaiah Thomas, and Isaiah Thomas will disappear. And guess what? Isaiah Thomas sent it on one move, Jimmy Butler, to bring him the hot chocolate or coffee, and scored over him, beside him, get the free throws, and show him who is the boss on the court. And that the size doesn't matter, only intelligence and basketball knowledge. So, Jimmy Butler is having like 19 out of 23 free throws, and the whole Celtics team is having 22 free throws. Which means that Jimmy Butler had more free throws, one more free throw than the entire Celtics team. For example, Isaiah Thomas, which is clearly better player than Jimmy Butler and the star in the league, top five players, I can surely say without any doubt, top five offensive players and overall players in the NBA. Isaiah Thomas tonight has only 13 free throws, and Butler had 23 free throws. And this is like bad officiating for Fred Hoiberg. And by the way, Isaiah Thomas had 5 turnover, 33 points, the same amount like Butler, but the difference is that Isaiah Thomas played 36 minutes and Jim Butler played 46 minutes and he scored 19 points free throws. Isaiah Thomas scored almost only 12 points out of free throws and 21 from the field. So this is the difference between the real star, Isaiah Thomas, and star on the paper, Jimmy Butler. About officiating, again, it was terrible, one-sided, the whole series. I will just give you, Danny, a couple of examples without going any further because I don't want to waste any more time on the Bulls and their statements. That technical to Isaiah Thomas was total bullcrap, for example, it was rewarded on free throw that Jim Butler scored. The technical for taunting, to Isaiah Thomas for taunting Michael Carter Williams, are you kidding me? Officials, NBA, what is this? Is this ballet? This is NBA playoffs? Do you know how many players, great players, trash talking and taunting the players on the court? So what? You're now going to play the teachers in the classroom roles. And when somebody gives the bad word to the other player, you're going to give him a technical foul. Is that what it is in today's NBA? If this is today's NBA, the officials and commissioner should be ashamed because it is turning to some bad comedy or ballet. Trash talking and taunting players is part of the playoffs. All great players in the past did. And getting free throws for this is totally ridiculous. Then, another technical at the end of the second quarter, I think, maybe I'm wrong, to Jay Crowder for complaining about another bad decision. So, the officials are going from one bad decision to another bad decision, which is technical to Crowder. Then again, the goaltending, clear, Stevens complained and he almost get technical himself. And Butler jumped on Smart and getting the free throws and then complaining about the Smart, which is ridiculous. Yes, Smart is the flopper, but you know, Butler is literally throwing himself to the players and he's getting the free throws. He gets in one possession without any contact the three free throws, for example, and etc. I can talk until tomorrow about officials. But again, I don't want anything to spoil me and the Celtics fans the great victory, so it is enough. The officiating was terrible, one-sided, conquered officiating. Jimmy Butler get more free throws than entire Celtics team. Isaiah Thomas was beaten like nobody else on the drives, and he was not getting the free throws. Officials gave three fouls to Avery Bradley early and Jay Crowder, and they tried to eliminate Jay Crowder and Avery Bradley. The same script, Daniel, like the game number 2, when they eliminated our primary defenders on Jimmy Butler, remember, those are, and the best defenders of the team, which are Bradley Crowder and Smart. So by giving three fouls to Crowder, to Bradley, two to Crowder and to Smart, two, later Smart received, if I'm correct, number three and four fouls. So the officials, practically gave the early, brought the Celtics into early foul troubles. And, Bradley and Crowder took care about themselves and, everything was fine. They didn't, get out. They were not forced to get out of the court because of six fouls, which is luck for us. So, your take on Jimmy Butler and Fred Hoiberg, and again, this is sign of fear, and when you are powerless to do something to change the series, you can only complain on the press conferences. What do you say then?
Well, you're right. He's pretty much in a position right now where he's trying to basically make the officials be the one to stop Isaiah Thomas because he's realizing that he can't do it himself. You know, after losing Rajon Rondo, Carter Williams and Cannon and Grant, those guys have not been able to prove that they can basically stop Isaiah Thomas. Heck, not even Butler, Wade, and the big dudes have been able to stop Thomas in the last two games from getting what he wants, whether it's getting a three or attacking the rim. So now he's basically in a position where he's saying, if our guys can't stop him, then we need to get the officials to be our allies to stop him. So I'm going to complain and say the only reason he's doing what he's doing is because you keep letting him get away with these violations. So like that, the next game, the officials will basically be zoning in on Isaiah. And if Isaiah makes the move, then it's going to have to be called because if you don't do it, then basically it makes him look like he's credible when it comes to his complaint. So that's his thing right now. But like you said, Igor, he's got to realize, do you know the advantages the officials gave you tonight and yet you still blew it as a team? The goaltending, as you mentioned, that call that they goaltended and got away with it. You know, if you look at the foul situation, Isaiah Thomas, ladies and gentlemen, had four fouls on him already in the third quarter alone and had to come out and then came right back in a few minutes later because the Bulls were starting to basically catch up and they took the lead ultimately. But Isaiah Thomas was the one that took over and got the Celtics right back in front. You know, so in this case, Isaiah Thomas was already at four. When you look at the foul situation, Igor, forget the free throws because again, as Avery Bradley said, you know, that's ridiculous. Jimmy Butler taking 19 of 23, and so who knows? Maybe we get fined if we keep talking about the foul situation and the free throw situation. You know, but when you look at the foul calls against each team's players, Jimmy Butler and Mirotic were the only main guys that got four fouls or more in this game. But when you look at the Celtics and their main guys, you had four on Jay Crowder, you had four on Isaiah Thomas, you had four on Kelly Olynyk, and you had five on Marcus Smart. All of those guys play a key role, three of which are Jimmy Butler's main defenders, as you said, Igor. So your best player had all his guys on the edge because of the fact that the officials were not allowing the Celtics to get physical with him without getting a call. And then yet you're going to complain because none of your guys could stop the smallest player on the Celtics, you know, roster. You know, maybe you can argue that maybe, you know, Terry Rozier might be smaller than him. But, you know, Isaiah Thomas is one of the smallest guys on our roster, which is why everybody was saying the Celtics team's not going to go anywhere because of the fact they're going to double-team Thomas and all that. And your boys, even with Lopez on the floor, have not been able to stop Isaiah Thomas. So you want the officials to do it. That's a bad look on his part because that shows him and his team, he's pretty much admitting we ain't got what it takes to stop Isaiah. And if that's the case, what makes you think basically you deserve to go to round two over the Celtics? The Celtics have stopped Jimmy Butler. They stopped him in game three, if you all recall. Jimmy Butler didn't have a good shooting at night. And then tonight, if it wasn't for all those free throws, Jimmy Butler would have scored a measly 14 points in 46 minutes. that is basically stopping Jimmy Butler, holding him to that type of number. So that's two games in a row you can say the Celtics defense did their job holding him when it comes to him shooting-wise. The officials basically had to help him with the free throws in order to make sure he had a decent out, you know, point, and it would go, the blame would go on everybody else. So I truly hope that the officials for game five don't be taking this coach seriously and start zoning in on Isaiah Thomas just to screw us because of the fact that he's trying to basically say the game is rigged against his Bulls when we know it's the other way around.
And I will add again that every single Celtics fans that are supporting Fred Hoiberg and Jimmy Butler's statements on the Twitter are total idiots. They should be ashamed of themselves, and they should not call. They have no right to call themselves the Celtics fans after some shameful statements during this series. But you know, Danny, some people just like to be the jackasses, obviously. So we heard after the first two games a lot of bitching and complaining about Ben Stevens, Danny Ainge not bringing the center at the trade deadline, or giving maximum contract to Horford. To the team policy and practically everything else. So I just wonder where those hot takers, Boston Sports Radio hosts are, the genius fans that know basketball more than Brad Stevens, then the ESPN guys. The Celtics will lose from the Bulls. Again, ESPN guy. And so, ESPN guys, the Celtics, the Stevens is the worst coach ever in the playoffs with a 2-9 record after the game 2. So again, the Celtics are surrounded with pressure from outside and inside. And I'm really disappointed in both Celtics fans and their basketball knowledge, because with those comments, Daniel, they are proving me that first two things. Number one, they have absolutely no clue about the basketball. We take time, but then one writer analyzed the great Al Horford playing and his contract, and he made some great points, and maybe we will talk about that on the show. Maybe not, depends on the outcome and the circumstances game number 5, and depending on the outcome of the game 5, if we have time, we will analyze a little about Al Horford. Anyway, Daniel, let's talk about the game and tell us the numbers, the starters, the difference in the game. What was the difference in tonight's game?
Well, overall, as you said, the free throw situation was pretty crazy, but in this game, you had Isaiah Thomas, who led the Celtics with 33 points overall in 36 minutes. He went 10 of 21 from the floor. He shot only 1 of 9 from downtown, but that lets you know that he was attacking the rim a lot tonight. 4 rebounds, 7 assists, and was called for 4 fouls. After that, you had the next highest, which was Gerald Green, who scored 18 points in 23 minutes, most of those coming in the first half. 7 of 13 from the floor, 4 of 9 from downtown, 7 rebounds, 0 assists, 1 personal foul called against him. Then Al Horford was the third highest with 15 points in 36 minutes, 6 of 11 from the floor, 1 of 3 from downtown, 12 rebounds, 4 assists, 1 foul called against him. Jay Crowder was the fourth highest with 11 points in 40 minutes. He went 5 of 9 from the floor, 1 of 4 from downtown, 2 rebounds, 1 assist, 4 fouls called against him. Then Kelly Olynyk was the next one with 10 points in 16 minutes off the bench, 4 of 4 from the floor, 1 of 1 from downtown, which was a pretty deep three-pointer, 3 rebounds, 0 assists, 4 fouls. Then it was Avery Bradley, who scored 8 points in 34 minutes, 3 of 9 from field goal, 1 of 6 from downtown, 1 rebound, 2 assists, 3 personal fouls called against him. Marcus Smart scored 5 points in 33 minutes, 2 of 7 from the floor, 1 of 2 from downtown, 8 rebounds, 6 assists, he got called for 5 fouls. Then Terry Rozier and Jurevko were the next ones that scored. They both scored 2 points. Rozier did it in 11 minutes, Jurevko in 10 minutes. Rozier went 1 of 4 from the floor, 0 for 2 from downtown, 1 rebound, no assists, no fouls, while Jurevko went 0 for 3 from the floor, 0 for 1 from the 3-point area, 3 rebounds, 2 assists, 2 personal fouls. When you look at the Chicago Bulls, Jimmy Butler, of course, scored 33 points, so Isaiah Thomas and him tied tonight for the high score overall. 33 points in 46 minutes for Butler, 7 of 16 from the floor, 0 for 3 from downtown, 5 rebounds, 9 assists, 4 personal fouls called against him. Then the next highest was Mirotić and Cannon. They tied for 13 apiece. Mirotić scored 13 in 34 minutes, 4 of 11 from the floor, 2 of 8 from downtown, 7 rebounds, 1 assist, 4 personal fouls, while Cannon, who was kind of the surprise of the night overall, scored 13 points in 34 minutes off the bench, 4 of 10 from the floor, 3 for 7 from downtown, 2 rebounds, 3 assists, 2 fouls. The only other player to make the double digits was Dwayne Wade, who scored 11 points in 38 minutes, 5 of 12 from the field, 0 for 2 from downtown, 6 rebounds, 2 assists, 2 personal fouls. Then Lopez scored 8 points in 22 minutes, 4 of 8 from the field, no threes, 7 rebounds, no assists, 2 fouls called against him. Portis scored 8 points in 23 minutes off the bench, 4 of 7 shooting, 0 for 1 from downtown, 8 rebounds, 1 assist, 1 foul. Then Laverne scored 6 points in 7 minutes off the bench, with 3 of 6 on the floor, 0 for 1 from downtown, 3 rebounds, 1 assist, 1 foul. And then the only other player to score was Felicio, as he scored 3 points in 10 minutes, 1 of 1 from the floor, 3 rebounds, no 3-pointers made, 0 assists, 4 personal fouls. Zipser and Grant both scored absolutely nothing tonight. So today, Igor, I think we can pretty much say the difference in this game was pretty much, in my opinion, the 3-point shooting. The Celtics, as a team, went 10 of 37 from the 3-point area tonight, 27%, while the Bulls shot only 5 of 24 for 20.8%. So that's another 15 points extra you had in your favor, you know. And, of course, Isaiah Thomas managing to match up Jimmy Butler made it where pretty much it was going to come down to Wade and all those other guys having to outscore the rest of the Celtics players. And, again, we've seen it throughout this series for the most part, other than Game 1 where the Celtics bench was really, you know, really terrible. In the last 3 games, the Celtics bench has outplayed the Chicago Bulls bench in this case, and they did it again tonight. And, of course, the rest of the Celtics starters outplayed the rest of the Bulls starters. So if Isaiah Thomas can do that every game where he matches up Jimmy Butler or at least keeps it close, the Celtics are going to walk away with this series as the victors.
Okay. So, again, when you look at the statistics, you will see that the largest lead Boston Celtics 20, fast break points Boston Celtics 17, the Bulls 9, the advantage Boston Celtics in fast break points 8 points, which is key number 1, 10 points in the paint, Boston Celtics 48, and Bulls 48, this is tie. Bench points, the Celtics 19, and the Bulls 30, which is Bulls advantage. The Bulls bench won the battle plus 11, if I'm correct. Yeah, so the bench is plus 11 Bulls. And finally, the second chance points, 17 Celtics and 10 Bulls. So the Celtics have plus 18 fast break points, plus 17 second chance points. Then the Celtics scored, I mean, 10 threes. Yeah, and like you said, the Bulls scored 5 threes, so the difference is plus 18 from 3 points line for Celtics. The Celtics made 10 threes and the Bulls made 5 threes, so the advantage is plus 18 points for the Celtics from 3 points line. Anyway, the game recap is that Isaiah Thomas has saved the Boston Celtics so many times this season, but never like this, a 2-1 series deficit, with his team crumbling, with the elimination game beckoning, after 20 points lead disappear, after the Chicago Bulls get pulled ahead, Thomas re-entered the game with four fouls, and proceeded to seize full control. Cutting into the paint, only his defender delivering one brilliant dish ever, after his shoe fell off, he dominated the end of the third, sent the Celtics to 104-95 win, and finished knocking off the first round series. King of the fourth, they call Thomas now for all of his late game scoring. This run didn't come in the fourth, but it came in the fourth game of the series. And it came with the Celtics danger of falling behind 2 games. No matter who the Bulls drew on Thomas, Isaiah Cannon, Jimmy Butler, Michael Carter-Williams, he danced by, found the paint, and created magic. The Celtics have been creating. They had committed 5 turnovers early in the third. They were forcing bad shoots, having all sorts of foul trouble guarding Jimmy Butler in the pick and rolls, and allowing Robin Lopez to dominate the interior defense and paint. They had fallen behind by 2 points after leading by 20, and then Thomas, 33.7 assists, over. He started the search with a couple of gritty finishes to get back the lead by 2. Consecutive points, and then turned unstoppable. During 16-5 run in the final 4:20 of the third, Thomas had 10 points and 3 of 3 shooting plus 3 assists. By the time the quarter ended, the Celtics lead it again by 9, which was pretty comfortable lead, and the Celtics never trailed. They needed important plays from Smart, 5 points, 8 rebounds, 6 assists, and Al Horford 15 points, 12 rebounds, 4 assists. Down the stretch, they needed a strong defensive effort. They benefited from the Bulls missing a lot of outside shoots. But with the game and the season on the edge, the Celtics turned great and has executed under the pressure on him, the ball pressure and mental pressure and every other pressure, self-media pressure, self-fan pressure, and everything else. The Bulls turned to Cannon. Jaren Grant start it again, but got pulled away, and Michael Carter Williams entered as a replacement. So the Bulls turned to Cannon. Isaiah Cannon hasn't played more than 7 minutes in a game since the All-Star break. Isaiah Cannon helped. With him on the court, the Bulls slide to Jimmy Butler at the point. The idea was to give Butler the ball, surround him with shooting, and see if they can finally score. Butler was great, attacking the paint, drawing free throws, putting Thomas and Bradley into foul trouble, but Butler wasn't the issue, but his teammates didn't make enough early shoots. Or late ones, really, they finished 4 of 22 for deep. And the Celtics, they made early shoots, a lot of them, especially Gerald Green, who tied his playoff career night with 16 points and 9-12 left in the second. The Bulls left it open a few times early. Green turned to the faucet and then the crunkles flowed. During the first half, he scored 16 points, 6 of 9 shooting, including 4 of 7 from 3. The Celtics took 22 three-pointers in the first and shooted 36.4%. So the shoot profile was close to ideal. 16 points in the paint in the first, 11 from the free throw line, 24 from the three. The Celtics took three mid-range jumpers before halftime, and in this series, it has paid to limit Amir Johnson. He didn't play at all, and the play as much shooting ball handling as possible. With Green in the starting lineup, again, the Celtics rushed out to 14-4 advantage and led by 11, and Brad Stevens' decision to spread the court as much as it is possible help, and Chicago defense send credit to another huge start. The Bulls came all the way back to 20-point deficit. Butler finished with 33 points, 9 assists, and 5 rebounds. The Celtics were in the tip of danger, but Thomas were there to save them. Do you have something to say about the game, Danny? I have a piece of the game and talked about Isaiah Thomas and the comments from, Gerald Green, because he deserved it, and Al Horford, because he deserved it too, and I want to talk about some stupid comments from the Celtics fans about Al Horford. So, what do you think about the game itself? Do you want to point out something from the game itself?
Well, I think overall the Celtics, another, thing we can look at is that overall today they did a little bit better in the rebounding department. You know, that's one of the things that we had said prior to the series, even starting, if you recall, Igor, we said the Celtics were going to have to try and win their fair share of the rebounding battles throughout these games, or at least keep it close. Don't get thoroughly out-rebounded in order to, in these games, because if you do, you're going to have problems. Of course, we saw that in the first game, or at least the first two, where Lopez was virtually dominating the Celtics and dominating the games, having control of the game itself because of the fact that he was getting so many offensive rebounds. Tonight, the rebounding battle ended up with 44 total for the Bulls to 41 for the Celtics. So that in itself is also a major victory, because you didn't see many offensive rebounds being done. If anything, you could say the Celtics and the Bulls in the end might have actually came away with roughly the same amount of offensive rebounds. The Celtics came away with 10 total, while the Bulls finished with 12 offensive rebounds. So even that is a major, accomplishment by the Celtics team, knowing that you were playing with only two bigs all night tonight in Kelly Olynyk and Al Horford. So for the most part, you were playing small against this Bulls team, with Lopez and Mirotic on the floor, Felicio coming in. So you managed to do that. I think one of the biggest ones of all was Gerald Green's offensive rebound. I'm sure you know the point I'm talking about, where he took the three-pointer and missed it, And unlike most players who just sit back or just start running back down the court, Gerald Green basically, the ball hit the rim and came right back toward him. He attacked the ball and was able to get a vicious two-hand slam. And of course, he started, you know, yelling in the air, screaming, like trying to, you know, show he's an animal, something like that. And then ran down the court. That got the whole Celtics bench completely fired up, including Brad Stevens, who, you know, who was still walking back and forth, but he was pretty excited seeing that, you know, stuff like that. Marcus Smart, I think, was, I think he got like maybe 4 offensive rebounds tonight. He got 4 offensive rebounds tonight, and a few of those came in the fourth quarter in very big-time possessions where, you know, Horford, you know, missed, or Thomas missed, and he came away with it, and it gave the Celtics a chance to milk the clock even more. That's something that we're going to have to continue seeing because, of course, again, if the Celtics rebounding, that's the biggest issue. And now it seems like they've actually fixed the issue, Igor, overall. They were getting thoroughly out-rebounded in games 1 and 2. Then yet now, come game 3 and game 4, the Celtics are winning. And now the rebounding situation is actually pretty close.
I just have to say a couple of things before. We will wrap up the show in like 10 minutes, but I want to discuss about some things. I mean, first of all, I think that Stevens finally showed in the rotations and found the great starting line of Danny, in the last minutes, I would say. So, in my opinion, he should start until the end of the playoffs is Brook, Crowder, Green, Horford, Bradley Thomas, because it is working so fantastic and amazingly on the offense, and they are not even bad at the defense too. He shortened the bench to 4 guys. Marcus Smart, Terry Rozier, Becker, Jonas Repko, Kelly Olynyk, Frontcourt, and that's the end. Brown played 1 minute, and Amir Johnson didn't play at all. So, keep it that way, Brad. Rozier, Olynyk, Zrebko, Smart on the bench, and one starter, whomever, Bradley, Crowder, or Horford. Keep it that way, and everything will be alright. Don't experiment, please. I want to address on some comments when I posted that Horford had another great game, like 15 points, 12 rebounds, 4 assists, plus 5, 1 block shoot, 1 shoot block, 54% field goal, 33% for 3, 100% for 1. He had one great statistical night and overall, and he made some cold-blooded 3 at the end of the game and some important shoots too. And the comments from one Celtics fan was, quote, Al Horford had to play that game, his game, so good because Robin Lopez was totally dominating him on the glass. Totally destroyed. Robin Lopez totally destroyed Al Horford this series. In that moment, I wanted to break laptop out of finger because please guys don't post so stupid statements. I mean, I understand that you are emotional guys, but watch the games and don't be emotional. Robin Lopez tonight has 8 points and has ±4. He has 6 rebounds, 7 rebounds and 2 turnovers. 50% field goal in 22 minutes, and he was non-factor unlike games 1 and 2. And Al Horford dominated Lopez in games 3 and 4. And this is one of the biggest reasons why Boston Celtics won the games number 3 and 4. Because Stevens made adjustments to put Horford on Lopez, and Horford finally stopped the Lopez, who look like Bill Chamberlain or Russell himself on the games 1 and 2 when actually Amir Johnson and Olynyk was guarding him. If you notice, Celtics fans, And for those of you which are not watching exactly the games, the primary defenders on as in one and two games were Amir Johnson and Kelly Olynyk. So go ask Amir Johnson and Kelly Olynyk why Lopez dominated us in the paint in the first two games. Not Al Horford. Al Horford had some another task in first two games. He was operating at the perimeter. He was passing the ball to the cutters and spreading the floor. And he was guarding Nikola Mirotic in those two games. But the crucial twist of the series is when Stevens made a twist and made a new lineup, small ball with Crowder on four, and Crowder tonight played 40 minutes and put Crowder at Nikola Mirotic and Al Horford at Lopez. It totally worked, and Al Horford dominated Lopez in those two games. So those statements that Lopez is dominating Horford are just not true. Go watch the games. Another thing that I wanted to emphasize, in my opinion, it will turn around, like I said, that Brad Stevens' starting lineup with Gerald Green is the winner of the series, not Rajon Rondo's injury, like Bulls fans are saying. And shorting bench to four guys and putting out of rotations Brown, who showed that he's not ready for playoffs, and Amir Johnson, who showed that he's not for the Celtics starters anymore. So Brad Stevens finally realized that and shortened rotations to nine guys, established the new great start five, and this is what is the biggest twist of the series. Gerald Green is providing the floor spacing. I want to talk about Gerald Green, the floor spacing at the starting unit. Danny and the guys, you notice that the Celtics have been running the stagger screen for Isaiah Thomas in order to free Isaiah Thomas from Jimmy Butler to put Jimmy Butler at his back. Exactly. That stagger screens were usually set by Horford and Gerald Green. So after Isaiah Thomas passes those screens, he get rid of Butler or his defender. And those two screeners screen. Green is popping out, and Al Horford is reading and reacting to what the defense is giving him, for example, rolling to the middle. And we are playing this play over and over, and if Horford is open, Isaiah Thomas is passing him for easy points, or Al Horford is throwing outlet pass to the three shooters, and offense is having so much space, Isaiah Thomas is having so much space in the middle of the paint, because now the Bulls defense cannot leave Gerald Green open, and if they leave Gerald Green open, you see what happens, 18 points, 54% shooting, 7 of 13, 4 of 9 for 3, Gerald Green. So it's not just Thomas and Bradley, they have to respect Gerald Green now. So the Bulls defense is usually overreacting. Their point guards are terrible in defending pick and rolls. They are usually making mistakes on every single Celtics possession. Lopez have to cover the point guards when they are out of the play. Lopez is running too high, and the middle is totally empty with the Celtics cutters and Horford being phenomenal in those last two games. And this is the key of success. And Gerald Green, again, kudos, veteran presence. He came cold-blooded. He started the last game 10 years ago, and he's playing like he's starting every single game of this season. Again, big kudos to Gerald Green. He's not only playing the great offense, but he's playing defense. And remember, guys, you have recorded when I praised Gerald Green. When we were reading Daniel, the scouting report of Gerald Green, and when we said going to be the spark plug from the bench. Celtics fans were actually laughing, you know, but Gerald Green is a tricky shooter, and it's safe to say that he saved us this series. Do you have something to say, Danny, about Green and the floor spacing and what I have been talking about in short notes?
Well, you and me have been saying several things needed to be done, you know, not only during these playoffs, but we've been saying stuff like that for several weeks, you know, throughout the second half of the season, pretty much. You know, we've been saying that Brad Stevens, you know, needed to stick to a set rotation and leave specific guys that he knew were going to be reliable come the playoffs, and let them get all the minutes to get themselves used to playing with each other as much as possible, because that's going to make them a much more dangerous team in the second half, in the playoffs. You know, you can't keep going from one guy to another, let another guy sit for too long, you know, because then that basically ruins those guys, you know, mojo, as they say. And it just ruins overall, you know, what you have going for you. Right now, the last two games, we've pretty much seen four guys in particular coming off the bench, which is Smart, Kelly Olynyk, Terry Rozier, and then of course you still have from time to time. But overall, you all know what I'm trying to say. That you need to have a set rotation. Jaylen Brown didn't get to play tonight. Well, he did, but towards the end of the game, for like maybe the last minute or so, which really that's not gonna do much for you overall when it comes to, you know, him having a impact on the game. But you're mainly making it where it's really Olynyk, Smart, and Rozier who are the main guys coming off the bench, and Jarepko, that's the other one. So you're sticking to those four guys being the ones that are going to come off the bench every game, and you're allowing them to basically go the route of playing with the starters and getting themselves in a set rhythm so that it can continue. And I hope that Brad Stevens continues with that. You know, don't go the route of now thinking, okay, because we're, you know, our guys are doing a lot better, we'll go the route of letting somebody else try to get hot. Or even if our guys go cold, Igor. I do not want to see our thing changing where all of a sudden now you give someone else, like say James Young or someone like that, a chance to try to come in hoping that they'll get hot all of a sudden. I want it to stay the same nine guys that you're using right now, which is, again, Thomas, Horford, Green, Bradley, Crowder, Rozier, Smart, Olynyk, and Jarepko. You leave it to those nine to basically do the damage. Now, further down the line in the playoffs, maybe Amir Johnson might get back into the playoff rotation, because, again, it always depends on what type of team you're facing, the matchups, things like that. You know, this Blues team is not a good matchup for Amir Johnson to be on the court, because Amir Johnson is, for one, he's a slow player overall. You know, he's thoroughly dominated by Robin Lopez. And by him being there, you're allowing Lopez to stay in the paint. And what you need is for Lopez to have to leave the paint, because then now the rebounds, it's a toss-up. Whoever gets to the ball first, Lopez has to run from wherever Horford is at, or from wherever Crowder is at, whoever he's having to defend. And if your guys are faster than Lopez, you're the ones coming away with it. With Amir Johnson there, it's been nothing but Amir down low and basically clogging up the paint, meaning Lopez is right there to block your layups. So, Brad Stevens, you got pretty much now the formula to actually win this series. You know the nine guys you need to use. Stick to those nine guys through the entire situation, no matter, you know, come hell or high water, as they say. You stick with those nine guys. You do not go screwing it up or messing it up for any reason. Whether the team is hot or cold, it's those nine guys you got to keep and let themselves shoot themselves out of a funk.
Yeah, I have, again, a couple of messages. You said to Stevens to stick to those rotations that he established, nine-man rotations, and the same starting five, which is winning, and he will win the series against the Bulls. And Danny Ainge, after this, please resign Gerald Green. and give the man the new contract, because you cannot find the better cheap slasher from the bench than Gerald Green. And he is the Celtics we drafted him, so the guy is living in, and you can see on every his emotional statements that the guy is the true Celtics, and he really impressed me during this playoff with his behavior, veteran leadership, with the way that he's playing. I love his game score because I love the streaky shooters, you know, the specialists, but after this series, I'm more impressed about him. Resign. We should resign Gerald Green. Every team must have one Gerald Green at the roster, the specialist, shooting specialist, instant offense, which will jump in and turn around again. The message finally for the Clowns of the Night, Fred Hoyt and Jimmy Butler from Chicago Bulls. Again, guys, you're the great step-up comedians. You should go to circus or apply to the Flying Circus of Monty Python. Those guys are dying to see you on the scene, complaining about the officiating in the Celtics series. Stop complaining. You better stop complaining and make some adjustments here, Bulls, Hoiberg and Butler, instead of complaining about the officials, because you are gonna be backdoor in the series. Celtics in six. I said it before the game one. I'm sticking to the prognosis. Celtics in five and six. Probably six. The game seven possible, but I don't think it will be the game seven. I think the Celtics will finish six. Though it is, I'm aware it is really hard to play the four consecutive great games, especially in the playoffs. And this is the only reason, the fatigue, and because the Bulls will play even without Rajon Rondo one of the next two games better than tonight. You don't have to doubt about it. But the Celtics must stay focused and the Celtics must stay focused, must play the way they are playing in games 3 and 4, and they will win the series, simple as that. But always again. So again, this is the end of live chat number 13. The Celtics defeated Bulls 104-95 in Chicago. The second consecutive game in Chicago. The Celtics are in the full control of the series again, and the series is tied 2-2. And the playoffs is now the best out of seven series, the best out of three games series, and the Celtics are having home court advantage again. So Celtics fans have a lot of reasons to be optimistic and satisfied. We can win the series, we can go to Eastern Conference at least, and the chances are increased, like you heard after this game, according to mathematical prognosis and the size for make for prognosis of the games. And if you like our analysis, subscribe to our YouTube channel, Celtics Talk Radio. Follow us at Twitter, Instagram. Find Celtics Talk Radio and Rivlin Green at the Facebook. And the next show is Thursday, 22nd, 7 p.m. Eastern. We are going to recap the game 5. Game 5 of the series is in Boston on Wednesday, 26th April. Either 8 or 8:30 p.m. Eastern. The time of the game depends on the Golden State Warriors game. And we will inform you the time of the game when we know it. So stay with us again. Watch our live video chat, recapping of the every Celtics playoff game, and listen to our weekly shows. We will have the great Thursday, and stay with us. And thanks for support, and we love you, and we are working on it for you. So go Celtics, and we are more optimistic than ever that the Celtics will win the game, the series, the first playoff series. 69% chance, according to BPI, to win the series. More likely 37% in 7 and 31% in 6 games. So that's all from us until the Thursday, and Celtics Talk Radio, Daniel and Igor are wishing you good night. Follow us, find us at the pages, and root for the Celtics. Daniel?
Yep, so as you said, Igor, it all depends on the game tomorrow, so for Celtics fans out there, again, if the Warriors win the game tomorrow against the Blazers, which means that they sweep the Blazers in 4, then Game 5 will be Wednesday night at 8:30 p.m. Eastern Time. If the Blazers win and force another game, then the game between the Celtics and the Bulls on Wednesday night will be at 8 p.m. So again, Warriors win, 8:30. Blazers win, 8 o'clock. So we'll all have to wait for tomorrow night and see what ends up happening. You know, so we'll all rest up and prepare. We got 48 hours pretty much, or less than, we have 48 hours, more than that actually, to get ourselves ready. Hopefully the team will be prepared. You know, we'll see what Isaiah Thomas ends up doing, whether he goes to be with his family or if he stays with the team. The team tomorrow does have it off, so they'll all be well rested to full practice on Tuesday. So we'll all see you Thursday night for our next radio show.
Have a good night. I really think that the Warriors will sweep Portland after the game 3, and we will probably play 8 p.m. Eastern, but we will inform. So have a good night all, and thanks for watching.